right, so we are here with Keith R.A. DeCandido, author extraordinaire, the hired gun, the man behind books for Supernatural, Aliens, Star Trek, his own series as well, the Dragon Precinct, Unicorn Precinct, Griffin Precinct, and the newest one, Mermaid Precinct. So it's a bit of a different spin than what we usually do, because most of us, you know, here, we're not really constrained by anything. Yet a lot of your books, you tend to have to be constrained by a canon, which is kind of cool. And I gotta say, I mean, some great, great intellectual properties. I mean, Supernatural, Star Trek, hell, man. I mean, that is awesome. So tell us, how did you get into that, man? That's
well, awesome. before we start, I have to say that my last name is pronounced DeCandido, actually, not DeCandido, but that's
DeCandido. I'm sorry. Look at me.
Don't worry about it. Everybody gets that wrong. I have spent 50 years DeCandido. I've spent 50 years correcting people mispronouncing it. I suspect I will spend the next 50 years correcting people mispronouncing it.
It
is my lot in life. Anyway, I actually got started doing this on the editorial side. One of my first jobs that I had when I was in my 20s was working for the late Byron Price, who was a book packager. And when I worked for him, I was one of his editors of science fiction and fantasy and horror and comic book stuff. And so I edited a bunch of different media tie-in stuff, different properties that Byron had acquired. Most especially, I was the editor of a line of Marvel Comics-based novels and short story anthologies. So we did Spider-Man novels and X-Men novels and Avengers novels and Captain America novels and Iron Man novels and all sorts of Hulk novels. In fact, prior, I was the editor responsible for those. We did about 50-odd books, both, like I said, novels and short story anthologies. And I like to say that prior to 2008... it was the largest interconnected series of Marvel Comics stories done outside of comics. And then Kevin Feige.
That's crazy. Thunder.
So,
crazy.
But unlike every other, I mean, there have been other people who've done Marvel and also DC based, you know, superhero novels based on those heroes. The one I did for Byron back then was the only one where it had its own internal continuity. I was doing that before it was cool, but anyway, I got started.
You run the gambit of them. I mean, just all kinds of stuff.
I got started writing it, actually with one of the first projects we did with Marvel, which was the Spider-Man anthology where, now a little background, Byron had spent 18 months negotiating this deal with Marvel. This was back when Marvel was its own corporate entity. It was before Disney bought them. But they were still...
He came a long way from a teacher in Philadelphia to where he went. Yeah, I know.
Oh, yeah.
This is crazy.
But he... They were the big scary monster of the comics industry. And they... it took a while to negotiate all the terms of the licensing deal. So when it finally happened, he wanted those books out as fast as humanly possible to start earning some of that money he just paid back. So we did a Spider-Man novel by Diane Duane called The Venom Factor. And then we were also putting together a short story anthology. This was in 1994. So this was called The Ultimate Spider-Man. This was before Marvel did their Ultimates line. So we actually did that first. But so we had a cover for the book, which had Spider-Man and four of his villains on it. It had Dr. Octopus, the Lizard, the Vulture, and Venom. We had a Dr. Octopus story, we had a Vulture story, we had a Lizard story. We did not have a Venom story. This was not for lack of trying. We had sent six different proposals by six different authors to Marvel, and they rejected all of them.
Nobody could put one together that sounded good?
When you're dealing with any kind of licensed property, like of the type that I've made my career out of since then, everything has to be approved by the people who own it. And particularly when you're dealing in the early stages of it, where everybody's still sort of getting used to what they want and what they don't want and what they're doing, it's hard to figure out sometimes it's harder to get stuff approved in the initial stages. So we were just hitting a brick wall with the Venom stories. And finally we said to them, look, what do you want to see? They gave us a sentence. At this point, we're past the 11th hour. At the time, I was working with John Betancourt. We were working together on the books, and then he left the company shortly after that. But basically, we didn't have time to assign it to anybody, so the two of us wrote it. And that was how I sold my first short story. Basically,
hey, it works.
Last minute editorial desperation was how I made my first story sale. And we wrote the story. It was called An Evening in the Bronx with Venom. And it came out in The Ultimate Spider-Man in 1994, 25 years ago. And it all went downhill from there. So
I did it all.
My first novel was a Spider-Man novel that was part of the line, which was called Venom's Wrath, which I wrote with Jose Arnieto. And I did some short stories for the line. I did a short story in The Ultimate Silver Surfer, in Untold Tales of Spider-Man, in The Ultimate Hulk, in X-Men Legends. And then I did a couple of short stories for some other anthologies, for a Magic the Gathering anthology, for a Doctor Who anthology. And then after the Spider-Man novel, I did a couple of Young Hercules novels. And then it's like a snowball going down the hill. The more work you do, the more likely you are to get more work. Because with tie-in fiction, you not only have to be a good writer, you have to also be able to satisfy licensors. And you have to be able to hit deadlines, because tie-in fiction in particular is very deadline-focused. So you need to be able, and I was able to do that. You know, my stuff generally got approved pretty quickly, and without many changes, which editors like that.
I was able to hit my deadline.
Who does your editing?
Go ahead.
Who does the editing, Keith?
Whoever the editor is at the publishing house. I mean, that's the... Yeah. With tie-in fiction... it doesn't, unlike with original fiction, tie-in fiction starts with the publisher. The publisher goes out and gets the rights to do books based on a particular property, like Byron did with Marvel, like Simon & Schuster did with Viacom back in 1981. And they still have that same license. You know, like Random House did with then Lucasfilm, now Disney, for Star Wars. And so on. It's what Warner Brothers did with Titan for Supernatural. It starts with whoever owns it.
Content ownership determines who edits. Okay.
Now, I'm sorry? You've also
not ownership. It's the publishing companies. Whoever, somebody at the publishing company is given the assignment to edit the books based on that particular property. One example that was an interesting one that I did back in 2013, I think, was the Fox show Sleepy Hollow.
I was going to mention that one. Yeah.
I did what turned out to be the only Sleepy Hollow novel. Random House acquired the rights to do Sleepy Hollow tie-ins. They did two books. One was a novel that I did, and one was the Secret Diary of Ichabod Crane, which Alex Irvine did. And when Random House got the rights, they assigned it to an editor whose primary stuff that she edited was historical fiction, which is why they thought she would be a good fit for it. But she had never done tie-ins.
Makes sense.
Yeah, no, it did, actually. And that worked in our favor. And she was great to work with, too. But she didn't know the tie-in field. She'd never done. So she did her research. And she approached a bunch of different people, including me. I think the main reason why she went after me was because I did the Supernatural novels. And I wound up getting the gig mostly because I was the only one who didn't quail at the deadline. everybody else was like, gee, I don't know, can you give me two more weeks? And they couldn't. It was a hard deadline because they wanted it released at the same time as the debut of the second season of the show. And when I heard the deadline, I was like, yeah, okay, no problem. And I hit it.
deadlines are good. Deadlines are important. And I got one thing I've been dying to ask. Don't die. Okay. Resident Evil Extinction, Resident Evil Apocalypse. You're slated for the books. Now, were those the books that got turned into the movies? And if so, so you did the movie, then you built the book after the movie. Okay.
Correct.
Because I saw those, and I was like, I didn't know about the dates, but yeah.
Yeah, no.
You had done the Resident Evil pieces.
I did actually three of them. There was also, we built it as Resident
Genesis.
Evil.
Genesis.
But it was a novelization of the first Resident Evil film from 2001, I think. And then in 2004, I did Apocalypse, and then in 2007, Extinction. There
so
was
you took it after the movie and then wrote the book. Yeah, okay.
Yeah, I in all three cases, I was given the script and I wrote a novel based on it.
So you got to take the script and turn it basically into a prose, you know, a novel.
Yeah. The one actually, the interesting thing about that is when you do a movie novelization, which I've done a few of,
right,
you have to add stuff. Because a movie doesn't have as much story as a novel does.
You don't have the thoughts of the character. You don't have a lot of the motivation sets. You don't have, right. Yeah, I get it.
But also just the actual story being told is not a novel's worth of story usually. Whenever somebody adapts a novel into a movie, they always cut stuff, which is why we have never seen Tom Bombadil on screen. But,
that's true. Ah, you get a point. You get a point. That's true. That's true. One example. I didn't think about that.
And
so you had to create filler.
Well, yeah. And in some cases, it's easier than others. Like when I did Serenity, I had all of 14 Hours of Firefly to play with. As additional backstory to work in. For Resident Evil,
great.
I had to basically come up with backstories for several of the characters. For Extinction, though, that was a great experience because at the end of the second movie of Apocalypse, they nuked Raccoon City, and that was it.
Yep.
Like, supposedly everything was fine. They contained it. They blew up the city, and everybody lived happily ever after.
I watched that about 6 months ago. Yeah, I'm trying to remember the timeline now.
Yeah, and then Extinction comes out, and the zombie apocalypse happened. It's like, wait a minute, how did we get from one state of affairs? The producers.
Then you tie in the Redfields, and then you tie in some of the other characters.
So they said, go ahead and fill that gap. You know, explain. Bridge the gap between the end of Apocalypse and the beginning of Extinction. In addition, they also specifically asked me to do something with the character of Jill Valentine because the actress who played her, Sienna Miller, was not available for Extinction. They wanted her for it, but she wasn't available. But they wanted the character to still be around for potential future movies, so they asked me to give her a subplot that basically explained.
So you couldn't kill her, but you couldn't have her in the movie.
That's what I was thinking. Okay.
Like, they're just gonna cack her off. Yeah, okay, she's dead. See ya.
Yeah,
some.
But no, they specifically wanted to keep the character available for future movies. So they said, give her, let us know what she was doing. So we did. It was fun.
About that, it's like, yeah, it's gotta be crazy doing. I mean, you did some of the Farscape books too, going back a bit, and I'm a huge Farscape fan. Love that show.
That was one of my favorite projects to work on.
Oh God, that would have been so cool.
I got to do, that was a comic book that I did for 3 years with Rockne O'Bannon, who created the show. And he and I got to
work with Rockne, because that's huge. I love, oh my God, that is awesome. Dude, it's huge. Are you kidding? Working with her, okay, right there is just, forget everything else. That right there is awesome. Everything else, who gives a shit? You know, you got to hang out with Rock. That's cool. No, right there. We can just end that right there. Nothing else needs to be talked about. We can talk about Farscape the entire night.
I'll sign off.
The greatest love story ever was the Farscape movie. Come on.
I think Rockne's my
best love story ever.
But Rockne's great. He was great to work with. He was. It was a lot of fun working with him on the Farscape comics. He had some wonderful ideas, and it was a true collaboration. You know, he came up with the basic.
I couldn't imagine. I mean, Rodney, that'd be huge. He's done so much stuff that's just out of this world.
Literally, in this.
Oh, that is just, I wouldn't have been able to talk. Like, more coffee, Mr. O'Bannon? You know.
the funny thing is, I'd write the script, and then we'd go over it on the phone. And it would take about 2 hours to go over the script, of which 1 hour was actually going over the script, and the other hour was exchanging bad puns. So,
that is awesome. That'd have been that'd have been up to one of the top 10 conversations.
Rodney is also responsible for my favorite note I have ever gotten on anything I've written. As if you're a fan of Farscape, then you know that bodily fluids are a very important part of the show.
Yes,
Farscape
they
is-
are.
Yes.
Especially things like
is
helium.
The only TV show in the history of television where a character's flaming pee is the solution to that week's problem.
And I remember that episode. I actually do. Yes, I remember that.
So one of the miniseries that we did had the crew suffering from a virus that made them aggressive and angry. And
okay. That's cool.
So I'm doing a breakdown of each issue Brocknet just gave me a general overview for the four-issue storyline. I'm doing a more page-by-page breakdown of the, how the plot's going to go before I start the script. And I did... And one thing I added was that the cure that they come up with, one of the side effects is you throw up. Because it's Farscape.
Right.
So,
it's far. So I get, yeah, there, you know.
And the note I get...
Only character ever fart helium, you know, Rigel. So, yeah, I get it.
So the note I get from Rockne is, love the puke. Who doesn't love puke?
I could see a note. Yeah, wielder of the red pen. Yes, yes. That's funny.
Yes, he loved so the puke. He also came up with the idea that Moya puked rainbows. and Will Slane drew it beautifully. The rainbow.
Awesome. Okay. The ship puked
the ship.
Rainbows.
The ship puked rainbows. Go.
That's awesome. Who doesn't love that? That's just,
exactly.
I would love to see that being written in. Oh man, that's killer. Well, who else? I got who else have you worked with? I didn't even know you worked with Rockne. That is awesome. Are you kidding me? Oh,
that's the only time I've actually worked directly. I mean, I've worked with most of the tie-ins. You know, you work with somebody in the licensing department. If you know, and if you're lucky, you might get to work with somebody who worked on the show. Every once in a while, I've gotten to. A couple years ago, when NBC revived Heroes, they did the miniseries Heroes Reborn. A bunch of us did novellas that were released that were companion pieces to it, and I didn't realize, we were getting notes from one of the producers. I didn't realize until the show actually was on the air that it was the showrunner giving me the notes.
That is awesome.
And I can't remember his name now, and I feel like an idiot, but it was the guy right under Tim Kring, you know. The guy who was actually running the day-to-day of the show. And this was great. It was, and this is becoming more common. It didn't used to be. We were kept in the loop on everything that was happening. We kept getting script revisions as they were coming in so we could make sure all our stories were as up-to-date and accurate as possible, which was wonderful. That's becoming more commonplace. It used to be that studios viewed tie-in fiction as an irrelevancy that they didn't really pay any attention to. But you're getting more and more people now running the TV shows who grew up reading tie-in fiction. They grew up reading Star Trek novels. They grew up reading comic books.
Exactly. They
grew up reading this stuff.
And
they want it to be, you know, as cool as possible. The Star Trek Discovery novels that are being done right now by Simon and Schuster are being done in collaboration with the writing staff. One of the members of the writing staff of Discovery is Kirsten Beyer, who's written a crap ton of Star Trek novels.
Right.
And she's been making sure that the novels hue as closely to what's happening in the TV show as possible.
She's doing continuity, yeah.
Yeah. And also, you know, helping them, you know, come up with, you know, all right, what do we want to see in tie-in fiction that won't, you know, step on what we're doing on the show, but can supplement the show in one way or another. And it's worked out beautifully so far. The another person I got to work with, I did a World of Warcraft novel and a StarCraft novel back about 15 years ago. I got to work directly with Chris Metzen, who was at the time was the guy in charge of the story development for all of Blizzard's properties. Chris was great. He was an absolute joy to work with. And then he left Blizzard shortly thereafter, and then suddenly Blizzard, you know, they changed direction, and I wound up not doing any more work for them. But the experience of those...
He did that after the last expansion, yeah.
Yeah. The experience of working with Chris was great. And Chris also recommended me for a gaming tie-in that I'm working in right now that I can't really talk about yet. But
it's
also a great experience. It's fun. It's a lot of fun working with... You know, the level of collaboration that you get could be a lot of fun. When it's done right, you know.
How do you... I mean, honestly... Because I know when I'm writing a book in my series, I got to go back and read the books in my series to make sure I'm not screwing up or doing something wrong. How do you? I mean, you take something like Supernatural with like 16 seasons, and you have to craft a novel. I mean, seriously, do you like binge watch all 16 seasons before you write? What do you do?
Well,
I mean, that's just I can't imagine.
The you know like I did a leveraged novel. There were only four seasons, so I could just sit down and watch all four seasons. Supernatural. At the time I was doing supernatural fiction, there wasn't as much. The novels I wrote were during the second season, third season, and fifth season. So yes, I could still binge watch it because there was enough to be manageable. Right. When I'm doing a Star Trek novel, obviously I don't watch every single hour of every single Star Trek episode. Because In that particular case, what I will do is I will choose episodes that relate to what I'm writing about.
Okay.
If there's something that it ties into specifically, it doesn't always. Sometimes it's just a straight up standalone adventure, in which case I'll watch a couple of episodes of the show it's tying into just to get the voices in my head. Because that's a very important part of writing any kind of tie-in fiction, is the character voices. Because, like, if it's your own character that you've created, you know what they sound like, and if somebody says you're getting it wrong, you can say, well, screw you, I created it. On the other hand, if I write Jean-Luc Picard in a way that doesn't sound like Patrick Stewart would say it, that's going to be a problem.
Yeah, if you write Jean-Luc like you would Kirk, you're going to have a problem.
Yeah.
You know, that's kind of
a perfect example. I did a Star Trek novella, which teamed up Picard and Sisko, which they never really did on TV past the first DS9 episode.
Nope.
Because when you're doing tie-in fiction, actor availability doesn't matter.
That's because Sisko and Picard had that whole problem because of the Borg incident. Yeah.
And I wanted to, you know, follow up on that. And there's one, they're taking a shuttle trip together. They're assigned to actually, it's a story that takes place during the period when the Klingons had stepped out of the Kittimer Accords on Deep Space Nine. So the Federation and Klingons were kind of at war. And since both Picard and Sisko had a relationship with Gowron, they were being sent to try to talk to him together.
I can see that. Right.
And so they're off in a runabout, tootling off. And there's one line of dialogue that I originally had Picard say, and then I realized, no, Sisko has to be the one to say it. And I wound up completely the entire sentence from the ground up because Avery Brooks talks differently from the way Patrick Stewart talks. And
he does.
They're
I keep seeing Hawk from Spencer for Hire.
But their manners of speech, their word choices are different.
He has a very interesting tempo when he talks. I mean, he's very specific.
Yeah. And I taught a workshop about 10, 15 years ago. On writing tie-in fiction. One of the exercises I gave them was to take Kirk's "Risk is our business" speech from the original series, in Return to Tomorrow, and to rewrite it the way one of the other Star Trek captains would have given it.
Oh, that's good.
Which was fascinating. I loved what they came up with.
I like that. That is good. Yeah, because you've got a. That's going to be one of the problems with writing these things is making sure you get the voices right. Not even on the main characters so much as a lot of the secondary characters. I mean, some of they're very specific the way they talk, but they're not necessarily prominent.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, in our industry, when you get Superboy fans, like we all do, they're going to grab it. Because they're the first ones who come out and go, no, 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 no. Episode 27, scene number 34, he would never do it like that, you know. Yeah, those are always fun.
One thing that makes life a lot easier, and how much easier varies from fandom to fandom, is the existence of wikis.
Yes, you're right. Awesome. Oh my god!
I don't know how the hell how I did this before that. It's like, you know, it's so much.
You're right.
Particularly, the Star Trek one, Memory Alpha, is phenomenal, and incredibly complete. Others, it varies. It's only as good as the people who maintain them, and not all of them are well maintained. But it's still, even the worst one is a useful reference tool to have. Just especially for something that's large, you know, something like Supernatural, like Star Trek, like Star Wars, where there's so many different parts of it.
Oh, there's such a canon to it. You've got to. I mean, literally, you can step on toes. I mean, this is one of the issues that I could see is. Stepping on toes, you've got so much to work with.
Right, or even just something as simple as crap, that something happened in some episode, and I don't remember which episode it was in, go look it up. Oh, right, that episode, and then you plug the DVD in. But,
it's crazy how that works, but I couldn't, I mean, when I think of a story, I have to go from the ground up, and you've done both, is it that much different when dealing with something like Supernatural or Serenity or Aliens versus doing your precinct novels? Is it the process?
Not at this point, because I've written 5 precinct novels and about 12 short stories. So I've got this huge, massive world, and I can't keep track of all of it.
Well, none of us can. I mean, come on. Exactly. Anytime you get over, like, 3 or 4 books in a world, yeah, I'm going back. I've actually had fans point stuff out that I screwed up. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. So have I. And I do the same thing. I sit when I'm writing another precinct story, I sit down and reread all the previous ones because I gotta.
Right? First of all, I hate rereading my stuff because nobody likes it. You know, nobody likes doing that. Well, I have them on audiobook, and the guy who does my audiobooks is awesome, so I can listen to them. I can't read my own stuff. I have to, yeah, I will sit there and throw it in a fire somewhere, you know? And I'll be like, who wrote this drivel? You know? I mean, literally. But yeah, I could, I mean,
I don't have that problem, but it's okay. All my readers, you know, that's what, according to my Amazon reviews, they all say, who wrote this drivel, so it all works out.
That's good. That's good. At least somebody's, you know, keeping track of who writes this stuff.
Hey, my favorite review ever on Amazon was on my World of Warcraft novel, where somebody wrote a lengthy diatribe about everything I did wrong in the book, ending with, this book sucks and I'm embarrassed to own it.
Oh, wow.
Which is my favorite review.
I
want to put it on the back of all my books, but my publishers won't.
That is good. Mine was, this guy is like a young Clive Cussler, however, he has learned the expertise of murdering the English language. That was my, and I was like, yes, at least I'm good at something. You know, I mean,
and you can just say, hey, you thought I was as good as Clive Cussler. Just leave it at that.
Right.
No, that's right. Yeah, I'll just leave that part of the review. And I was like, exactly. Oh, I didn't even see that. But I thought it was funny as hell. But yeah, you run some interesting novel sets. And I got to say, I mean, your Star Trek, first of all, Star Trek is holy writ, you know, for most geeks. And you come along and write a Star Trek novel. I mean, I could see that going south. I mean, seriously. Because I'd be scared to pick up that, because that's, you go to some places and you get something wrong, you're going to have people with, like, you know, phasers, you know, throwing stuff at you. And, yeah.
It's actually, in general, my experiences with the fan bases have all been pretty good. Some have been worse than others. There's always one subset of any fandom that's going to hate your guts no matter what you do. I don't worry about it. I started out as a critic. I'm still a critic. I still write reviews of things. And, oh, look, you can see me now.
Hey, hope we can see you. Hey, hi. Yeah, there you go.
Yeah. And I don't cry foul when people complain about what I do, because I don't expect anybody to complain when I review them and say not nice things. It happens. You can't please everybody anyhow.
Absolutely. We know this.
When I get, like, particularly when my first Supernatural book came out, I got a bunch of people. I would get, this is reviewing the same book, mind you. One person saying, well, he obviously hates Dean and writes Dean terribly, but likes Sam. And give Sam too much to do. And then the next review says, he obviously hates Sam and writes Sam all wrong and gives Dean everything to do, which I think said more about the people writing the review than it did about what I was writing.
Hallelujah.
And particularly in the early days of the show, a lot of people had their own interpretations of what the characters were like. My favorite. There was one thing. I had Dean picking a lock in one of my books. And okay. Somebody on, I think it was LiveJournal, because there was still LiveJournal then, saying, yeah. Well, obviously he doesn't know anything about the show because Sam's the one who picks locks. What did Dean do while Sam was at Stanford? Did he, like, come to a locked door and go, oh, well, and go off? Secondly, the next episode that aired after that review went live had Dean picking a lock.
Yes.
And I was only a little bit smug.
I've been flipping people off. I'd have been like, ah, see, look, right? Yeah, that's right.
Having said that, I screwed things up too. I got Dean's eye color wrong in the first book. I screwed it up.
Anybody catch that? Yeah, anybody actually catch that?
In my defense, the show is very dark.
Yeah, that is true, yeah. Looking at Dean.
I screwed it up, and I cop to it, including in the next book, in my second Supernatural book, I had Dean flirting in a bar with a woman, because Dean.
It's Dean, right?
Yeah. And she says, you have the most wonderful, whatever the wrong color I got was. And Dean's like, how the hell can she think I have that? What kind of idiot would think I had that color eyes? You know, so I made fun of myself.
That's clever. I do like that. I got to say, I did have one what the fuck moment. And after I thought about it, I thought, how cool is that? You know, going all your books and everything you do makes sense. And then I got to Leverage. And I went, you know what? I went totally out of, everything else you do is very sci-fi, very fantasy. And then there's Leverage. And I went, but I like the show.
I love the show.
And I went, that would be cool.
Also, it has...
that's probably one of the coolest things he did. He probably had so much fun writing the Leverage book because that would be awesome. Literally.
Also, there's a lot of genre cred on that show. Jonathan Frakes was one of the regular directors on the show.
He was.
The co-creator John Rogers and showrunner John Rogers wrote the Blue Beetle comic book for a bunch of years.
Okay.
Yeah. Jeffrey Thorne, who's written a bunch of Star Trek fiction and done some other and done some comic book work, was one of the writers on the show. There's plenty of genre cred there anyhow.
But it was one of those things where it's
I love the show.
Oh, the show was awesome. I mean, it was always over the top. The way they did everything was wonderful. It was almost like Ocean's 11 every week, man. Everything was on the spot. And I was like, how cool would that be to write that? You know, figure out that
tremendous fun. I absolutely loved it.
One of these days I'm going to be able to nail something like that. But I just keep looking at that going, that is so awesome to do. You know, it really is. And I realized at that point, I said, okay, yeah, because I would have jumped at it in a second. Are you kidding?
Oh, that was one case. At this point, some of the tie-in work I get is from people approaching me. Like Sleepy Hollow, they approached me. World of Warcraft, they approached me. Others.
You're like the guy to go to, man. I've seen all the stuff you've written. You're like, we've got a book we need to write. Go to Keith.
Some of them are ones where I was like Donkey in Shrek at the back of the room, jumping up and down, going, pick me.
I do that. Yeah, that'd be me all the time.
Farscape was one of those.
Oh, really? Because I'd have been standing on a chair for Farscape. Are you kidding?
Oh, yeah. That was me, for sure.
Don't choose the retard who fell off his chair in the back, you know?
Yeah.
But yeah, no, I love that. What is your, you've written so many different canons. What's your favorite? What's your favorite to dig into?
Oh, God.
You know, I think it was Farscape, but that would just be because I love Farscape.
It's a tie between, really, Star Trek and Farscape. Star Trek because I grew up with it. I have literally been watching Star Trek since birth. I grew up in New York City in the 1970s watching Star Trek on Channel 11 here in New York on reruns every weeknight at 6 o'clock. That was our nightly ritual when I was growing up. We'd watch Star Trek at 6 and then we'd have dinner at 7 every night. And
that is awesome.
Yeah. So I grew up with that. I remember as a very young child being incredibly frightened by the salt vampire from The Man Trap and the big green glowing fat guy from And the Children Shall Eat.
Absolutely.
For years, I couldn't watch either of those episodes because of childhood trauma. I got past it with the salt vampire. I never bothered with And the Children Shall Eat because it's a terrible episode anyway, and I'm still traumatized by big green glowy fat guys. But they're Hollywood attorneys. But
man, who is it? You know, come on.
Didn't the Gorn piss you off and weird you out? I mean, the Gorn got me pretty bad.
Gorn never bothered me. I thought that
the vampire chick the sucking the salt was kind of bad. That mug was just really
That gave me nightmares, man.
Circular mouth and it was just
And the sad, weird kind of pulled down eyes. What was that all about? The prosthetic guy
scared
wrong.
The crap out of me. But having said that, I grew up with Star Trek. Star Trek has been part of my life for my entire life. And so getting to write anything for Trek is a joy for me. Farscape only because I got to do so much cool stuff with it, including basically the virtual fifth season of the show. Comic book we did was a continuation of it. And being able to contribute that significantly to it was wonderful. And getting to work with the creator of the show, which I only did the one time. There's a few other times where I've had like stuff approved by the creator. As an example, Leverage, John Rogers did the approvals on the Leverage books. Actually, one of my Supernatural books was approved by Eric Kripke. because
oh, that's kind of cool.
It was timing. I finished that book when the last writer strike hit in like 07, 08, around then. And when normally the book would be approved by somebody at Warner Brothers licensing, but Eric Kripke literally had nothing better to do because he was on strike.
That's awesome.
And from that point forward, at least as long as Kripke was the showrunner, I honestly don't know if that continued after he left. But at least as long as he was showrunner, it was somebody in his office who approved the books.
I have a, I've got a listener question because I know somebody's going to ask this. Earlier, you mentioned that you're involved in game content, but you couldn't divulge how or why, which is cool. Have you been down that path before, novelizing existing game content? Has it been something? Okay, yep. Can you divulge some of that?
Because oh, sure.
That's fascinating.
Well, I mentioned World of Warcraft and StarCraft. I've done stuff in both of those worlds. I did a Dungeons & Dragons novel back in 2011, which was based on the Dark Sun world. I did a Command & Conquer novel back in 2007, which was tied into the Tiberium Wars game that was released by EA in 2007. And the novel I wrote was a parallel to the story of the game.
Was that a prelude or was that after?
No, it was a parallel story with the game story. So
okay.
The novels told other stuff that was going on at the same time as the gameplay. Most recently, my most recent novel, in fact, was Alien Isolation, which was based on the video game.
Oh, that's cool. Yeah, I saw the book. I didn't know it was based on the video game. That's kind
of
cool.
Yeah. It's about 2/3 a novelization of the video game action and 1/3 Ripley family backstory. So.
Oh, that's even better. Who doesn't like Ripley family backstory?
That was the fun part for me. I mean, yes, novelizing the game was cool, and there was action, and there was flamethrowers and people shooting things and stuff.
Right. You get to add to the Ripley story.
But the fun part for me was developing the character of Amanda Ripley and fleshing her out and getting into her backstory, which was tremendous fun. I had a great time with that. It's funny. After I announced that I was doing the book, a lot of people were coming up to me at conventions and saying, so is your novel entirely Amanda hiding in a closet? Because that's what I did when I played the game.
Ah, that's funny, but it's true. I mean, yeah. One of the questions I'd probably get from people, and one of the interesting things is you actually did or were involved in a series on Star Trek that I thought should have been its own show, Corps of Engineers.
Yes.
You did the Corps of Engineers. I love the Corps of Engineers. I'm an engineer. I love the Corps of Engineers. You know, what a great concept. And it was a series of books. Was it 7 books, I think it was? 7, something like that? And it was you and a couple other authors.
It was more than that. It was the series was created as an ebook series. And
right.
In 2000.
And it was Susan Picard
and
Mac.
To the launch of the Microsoft Reader in July of 2000. And,
that's funny.
And so we did it. And then from 2001 until 2007, we did monthly ebooks. Novella-length ebooks that were released on a monthly basis every month without fail, and then we collected them into paperbacks later on. There were 11, 12 trade paperbacks.
Were there that many? I thought it was seven or eight. Okay.
Yeah, there were 7 mass market paperbacks, and then 4 or 5 trade paperbacks. There's still a bunch of them that were never collected, but I don't know.
Oh, it was a great premise. I always thought it should have been its own show. I mean, seriously.
We had tremendous fun with it too. I was the editor in charge of that, and I wrote a bunch of the stories as well. And it was almost like running a TV show in a lot of ways. You know, because we had to get it out every month, and you know, the writers were coordinating with each other, and we had, you know, character arcs continuing from month to month.
Now you got, I mean, so much stuff. What are you working on now? Let's get you some plugs, man. You got a bunch of stuff out. What are you working on? What's the new stuff? Come on, what's the hot?
Well, the new stuff that's out is...
That you can talk about, yeah.
Yes, Alien Isolation, like I mentioned.
Right.
That's out from Titan. There's Mermaid Precinct, which you mentioned, which is the latest in my Precinct series. The Precinct series is a fantasy police procedural. It's kind of Law and Order meets Lord of the Rings. One reviewer called it Dungeons and Dragnet, and I love that description. It's perfect. And it's in a high fantasy, epic fantasy style setting with humans and elves and dwarves and wizards and magic and stuff. But the main characters are cops who solve crimes. It's two characters who are the Lieutenants Torin Van Wibbled and Danthris Tressilian, who go out.
Welcome, Dano. Yeah.
And there have been Mermaid Precinct is the fifth novel in the series. I've got three more novels coming. There's also a short story collection called Tales from Dragon Precinct, with another short story collection, very imaginatively titled More Tales from Dragon Precinct, coming eventually as well. But Mermaid Precinct is out now, and I'm hoping to do Phoenix Precinct, which is the next one, next year. I also debuted a new urban fantasy series this year called The Adventures of Bram Gold, which is takes place here in New York City, where I'm from, specifically in the Bronx. Lots of people, when they write stories about New York City, what they're really writing is Manhattan south of 125th Street. There's a lot more to the city than that. There's four other boroughs. There's Upper Manhattan. There's a whole lot more city. And I specifically wanted to write about the Bronx because I've lived here for most of my life. And there's a lot of cool stuff here. And so Bram Gold is a courser, who's sort of a hunter for hire, who deals with supernatural stuff. It's kind of a mix between the TV show Supernatural and the Dresden Files in a lot of ways.
I like the Dresden. A little butcher action there. I get it.
So the first book is called A Furnace Sealed, and that came out this year. It's out in hardcover, trade paperback, and ebook, and audiobook. The audiobook is phenomenally read. You were mentioning before about how much you love the reader of your books.
Oh, yeah.
TJ Clark absolutely nailed it. His audition audio came in, and he sounded exactly like what Brahm sounds like in my head. It was really scary.
Oh, that's awesome.
It's first person, so that getting that character right is kind of important. And he just nailed it. And the Bronx is a very ethnically diverse borough, and I reflect that in the book.
Right.
And TJ had to do a lot of different accents. And
that is awesome.
Bless his pointy little head, he nailed all of them. he did a really good job. A Furnace Sealed is out now. I've already plotted out the second book, and I'm hoping to have that out also next year. Other stuff I'm working on, currently I've got a couple of collaborative projects. One I can't really talk about either. But the other one is a military science fiction novel. David Sherman has written two books in a trilogy called The 18th Race. The first two books are Issue in Doubt and In All Directions. The third book is called To Hell and Regroup. The problem is David's been having some health issues, and he's not really able to finish the book, so he asked me to finish it for him.
Oh, that's awesome. So, that's a hell of a thing.
Well, I edited the first two books.
That's a hell of an honor.
So he trusted me to finish it for him. So I'm working on that right now, and I'm trying to keep to his style, and you know, he did a good considerable amount of work on it, so I'm just basically just finishing it for him. We're hoping to have that out later this year. And I'm working, and honestly, that's all I can. Like I said, I'm working on the next books in the Precinct series and the Bram Gold series. I'm hoping to do more Alien books. That's still nothing's written in stone yet.
But that'd be fun. Are you kidding?
Yeah, I want to do more with Amanda specifically. But whether I do or not, you know, we'll see how things go. Things are a bit up in the air because Fox got bought by some other company.
I heard about that.
Yeah, some obscure company with a mouse as their mascot.
Some weird ears. Yeah, there's a thing with a guy in a duck.
So that's obviously Alien is one of the things they're not going to mess around with too much, but there's been enough changes there that we don't know what the hell's going to happen. But, I mean, there's still going to be more Alien books, but we don't know.
Right.
We don't know the specifics. There's other stuff happening, but I'm hoping to do more. The response to Isolation has been really good. So that's...
Has it? Okay, good.
That's encouraging.
Yeah. Now, from a user, or we'll call it a listener standpoint, we got a lot of newer authors listen. How did you get into this? I mean, this is completely off different than what most people do as an author. They tend to write books, but getting into...
Well, like I said, I got into it from the editorial side. It's not really something that's replicable.
and that's okay. That's one of the things I wanted to, you know, this is not something you can just go out and do. you know.
Yeah, it isn't. I was lucky in that I was in a position to pitch stuff. A lot of the early tie-in assignments I got were from people from whom I had bought fiction as an editor.
Okay. That's kind of cool.
You know, I did a Doctor Who story, which was in an anthology. This was back when Virgin had the Doctor Who license.
Wow, okay. The
Decalogue anthologies. This was back in 96. And
Before the new series, but after the old one, that was, yeah.
Yeah, okay. It was during the interregnum between the two series. And
You were still working with McGann at that point. There was still McGann as the Doctor.
Actually, the McGann movie 96? Came out that same year, but it hadn't been released at the time of putting the anthology.
Oh, okay. So you had done a McGann movie. Okay.
So yeah, this technically, I mean, the book actually came out around the same time as the McGann movie, but in terms of when it was being solicited and stuff, it was before that. But the editors were Justin Richards and Andrew Lane. Andy had written two short stories for me for a couple of the anthologies that I was editing.
Right.
Including one of the X-Men anthologies. And he happened to mention in passing that he was putting together a Doctor Who anthology, and I was Donkey and Shrek again. Pick me.
Oh, I could see that. Yes, Doctor Who. Are you kidding?
Yeah, I've been watching Doctor Who since I was 10.
Yeah, Baker was like the man for me for a long time. I know. I might know a thing or two about Doctor Who.
Yeah. I've been lucky in that I've been able to do a couple of short stories, and I also edited Big Finish for a while was putting out the Short Trips anthologies.
Right.
I edited one of those.
That is awesome.
Which was
that
is awesome. The Quality of Leadership. Which is great because I got to hire Peter David and Diane Duane and Una McCormick to all write Doctor Who stories. They'd never written Doctor Who fiction before. Una, by the way, has gone on to write actually like a whole bunch more for like the
really.
But that was her first one. That's huge. It was great fun to do.
Oh man, I can imagine. I mean, and from the sound of it, it sounds like you pretty much do nothing but just, you know, pretty much get up in the morning, breathe, and write until you go to sleep at night. From the sound of it, I mean, literally.
Well, I do other things too. I also, I'm also a martial artist. I teach karate to kids three days a week.
That's
and fun. I train. And I also and you know, I do some editing work. I do. Yeah. Various things. I keep busy. I also been doing a lot of nonfiction. I've been writing regularly for Tor.com.
Tor short stories? Yeah.
I'm sorry?
That's cool.
No, not short stories. I've been writing essays and reviews and rewatches of old TV shows and stuff for them.
Oh, that's cool. Yeah.
Currently I'm doing a rewatch of every single live action movie based on a superhero comic.
Wow, that's a lot of movies. I mean, are we getting into like some of the really nasty ones? Like the first time we did the Fantastic Four, it was so bad they took the titles out of it. I don't know if you remember that one. It was so
I covered bad. That one.
Oh my god!
I am being very complete here. I've been going vaguely chronologically.
Most people have never even seen that movie, but I remember that.
For good reason, it's terrible. Yeah.
Oh, it was horrible. It was actually the worst movie.
I started with Superman and the Mole Men and the 66 Batman. I worked my way through all the terrible 70s TV movies and
oh, wow. Like,
Kathy Lee Crosby, Wonder Woman. Like
did you get the Flash TV show, the one that was really bad in, like, the 80s? Yeah, that was horrible. I remember
I love that show, but...
it was cheesy, but yeah.
I did the pilot.
Did you do Greatest American Hero, though? Because if you're going to do Superhero,
It's not based on a comic book. I'm specifically doing...
That's true. Okay, yeah, I get that.
I'm specifically doing stuff that's based on... I've stretched the definition of superhero quite a bit. I did the two Flash Gordon movies. I did Men in Black. I did a few others that are iffy. But... I did Monty Blaze, and I did Valerian and the City of a Thousand Planets.
That's right. I can't do anything right now. I'm researching. Hold on. I gotta go back to it.
But
I'm
coming into the home stretch now. All I've got left at this point is phase three of the Marvel Cinematic Universe, which I just started last week as we record this. 2 weeks ago as we record this. And then... once I get through all of those, I've got basically all the 2019 releases, which I couldn't get to because they didn't exist yet. But I'm basically gonna finish the year this year and start next year with all the 2019 releases that aren't part of the MCU. So it'll be like Shazam and Men in Black International and Joker and Dark Phoenix.
Dark Phoenix, but Shazam wasn't bad. But yeah, no, that's
And Hellboy.
Hellboy, the new one? Okay.
Yeah, I already covered
the two. Perlman, I like.
I covered both of those, but I didn't. You know, once I get to that, then I'll have caught up to real time, so I don't know what the hell I'm going to do. But,
Well, you probably go outside and see sunlight. I know it's weird. I don't do it very often, but I hear it's nice. Everybody tells me it's nice, you know? And thank you, by the way, for coming on and talking with us tonight. I appreciate it. I know from the sound of it, you're very busy, and it's not DeCandido, it's DeCandido, right?
DeCandido.
DeCandido. Yes. Thank you. I just want to make sure I got it right. We are on with DeCandido. I will make sure the links for his Amazon books are up on Office and Chains, and also the Office and Chains pane he currently has right now. If you guys want to go out and get it, he has Mermaid Precinct, Alien Isolation, The Adventures of Brom Gold, which is called A Furnace Seal. That is what's the newest stuff he has out, but he has pages of books you can go back and read from various canons, including Star Trek, Farscape, you know, World of Warcraft, and just about everything. You've probably read something by him and don't even realize it. And you may even like it.
Well, let's not get crazy.
I know, we won't get too excitable. But no, thank you, Keith. I appreciate you coming on with us tonight. We'll let you get back to it. Anybody else have any questions? Are we good to, are we good on that?
I'm just thoroughly entertained.
Oh, she's over here being entertained. She's being fangirl.
I was going to tell you two to like stop talking so much.
I know, right?
I'm just like absorbing it all.
They're always interrupting me. I don't know what the hell their problem is.
Drink it in. Drink it in. The moment will change the next time we get you isolated, pal. Don't worry about it.
Oh, yeah. Don't worry. They'll get you back into a damn corner. Then you'll be really in trouble.
Thanks for coming on, Keith. That was cool.
Oh, thanks, guys. All right. We'll talk to you later. All right.
And let me know when this goes live so I can pimp it for
I'll have it up tomorrow, and I'll link it out to you so you can have it.
Groovy. Oh, by the way, I never read the comments shirt. It took me a minute to realize what all it said there. But.
Oh, yeah. No, she's got her cool shirt on. Yeah. What is it? Show me shirt.
Yeah.
Never, ever read the comments.
All I saw was the never, ever, and it's like, what the heck is this? I didn't want to say anything in the middle of the interview, but then, yeah. Then you should. Love is like a bomb, 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 bomb.
Forget October 5th, we are in Atlanta. That's right, Authors and Chains, we're broadcasting live from Atlanta. So check the Facebook page, it's going to have time and place. Come on down, see us broadcasting live, and hey, maybe get on the air. But we expect to see you there October 5th. Love is like a bomb, 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 bomb.